Hi.
Hi.
Hi, River.
Hello, Morgan.
Hi. Welcome everybody who's tuning in. We are so happy you're here for this public conversation about River Ramirez's beautiful new work, Ghost Folk. And I'm just really grateful and honored to be in conversation with you, River. I've been loving you and collaborating with you for a number of years. And so I'm really just welcome to this work into the world. And yeah, hi, and thank you to Maria, our ASL interpreter.
Yeah, thank you so much. Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
Oh my God, I'm so good. I'm doing my best Terry Gross. I'm gonna do my best Terry Gross. Okay.
You look amazing. I feel like underdressed.
You're
Like when I
perfect.
saw you in your blazer, I like immediately wanted to put shit on my face.
Yeah, that's
Did
that
you say
way, you
shit?
know. What I mean, I think, yeah, we can say it's art. We can say whatever we want.
Right? It's like a
Listen.
corrupt industry.
Exactly. So, River, will you just like I assume everyone who's watching this has already seen your beautiful piece, which is up online until November 1st. But will you just this is like a development in your practice, and like, can you just talk about like the genesis of this project, Ghost Folk, how it came to be?
Well, during pandemic, during the darkest days of pandemic, I started getting more seriously into guitar. I had just started, and it's like what kept me going throughout pandemic. It was like another art form that allowed me to like tune in with myself without thinking of the like, oh, will this turn into a job or something like that? It was just for the pure enjoyment of like art making and just like vibing with myself, if that makes sense. So that's where it started from there. And having a lot of time alone, I played guitar every day the whole pandemic. I started making songs, and it was always like my dream to like make songs, but I was always too shy. And in my stand-up, I like kind of did that. Yeah, I don't it just started it's just something that organically happened. And then I started writing. I read this book called Ordinary Girls, and it's about someone's life in Miami, and I really related to it. And I was like, wow, these stories are like so close to my own stories. And for so long, like in stand-up and stuff, I had been like some people call me like an absurd stand-up comedian or something, or very surreal. And I feel like I am, but I also have a lot of my stuff is rooted in my real experiences. And then I just take off with it. But I had this moment of like, wait, why do I think my stories are boring, or why do I think my stories are not worth being told? Like they're not interesting, because I had this feeling throughout stand-up that I'm like, I don't really want to share personal things. And I started writing stories throughout pandemic, so I was like learning guitar, writing stories, really like practicing with my voice and stuff. And I'm a voiceover artist, so I already use my voice, but it was just kind of like a wake-up call, I guess, to and especially with everybody dying around and like there being like a killer disease on the loose, I was like, damn, you have this one life. What do you do? How do you celebrate that you're living? How do you celebrate that you're alive? I celebrate it through my artwork, through the process of making, and I want to make, and I like really was like, oh, I want to make something that I haven't made before. I want to go into new territory and see how I can express myself the most fully. Like, how can I really show I'm really into God? I'm like, we talk about God.
Save space for God.
There's space for God. I was like, how do I show whatever the creation is, wherever that stems from, whatever God is, like that I'm here and I'm alive and I'm grateful and I'm using all of it. I'm using all of it. And how can I show that in a way that compels maybe other people to also do the same, like using your life force completely.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So that's yeah. Thank you so much for all of that. And it all comes through. And, you know, just like listening and being with the work a number of times, it's like the multidimensionality of it, of like all the ways in which you're speaking to us through song and stories and jokes and dance and the visual, and saying that same, you know, with this same message. And I just wanted to read back to you the first words that you say in the show. You say, a new day begins much like the Big Bang, but much quieter, more internal. After the descent into darkness, suddenly we enter a new day, knowing more about ourselves than we've ever known. And then you later say, you know, because our voices are needed, our bodies are needed, because after the plague, we were the only ones left living. And I just wanted to like, those are so, like, it took me a while to like hear those words. And it's like, I think they're so beautiful. What's it like to hear your words?
Yeah, I mean, that's basically what I just said, I guess. Like, yeah, we just experienced like everyone in the world just experienced something that had united us, in realizing that our time here is finite and we were left to think about ourselves, and there is no going back to the way things were. So it's like, how do I propel myself and encourage others, but also like, it's just really just like about me. But I also feel like, mm-hmm. you know how in like meditation, they're like, when you like the, it's like the universe is inside of you, and the only way to like function in the world is to like really know yourself and have moments for you, because like it's not about the external world. It's like, yeah, a lot of this is like very much tied into my own spiritual practices too. But yeah, that's, I feel like that the beginning is it.
Yes.
It's like, it's also like, I like that you said it took time to hear it, because I'm like, that's great, because it's supposed to be like very like performative, over the top, so that you're like, oh, ha-ha, like just a little, right. You know, kind of like how music is like, ooh, fun, yeah. But then you hear the words later and you're like, oh my fucking God.
Right.
That's the vibe. And I think that's also why I chose music. You know, usually I speak to people and it's very like, and I wanted a softer approach now in this new day of like, oh, I want to say shit, but I don't want to be, now that we went through such a dark thing, like, I don't want to be really harsh. I want to do it with love, lovingly, with beauty. Mm-hmm. I want to communicate through beautiful things.
Mm-hmm. And there's so much beauty in this, and the songs are just so beautiful into themselves, and so beautiful to listen to your voice and the music, and to hear you, your group together. So what was it like working with your two collaborators? What was it like to bring this about together?
So I worked really closely with Lou Tides, who's the bassist, throughout pandemic, would send her songs, and I have like a whole bunch of songs that never became this, because then I went through like a breakup, which like transformed my journey also too, because I was like kind of like left with this feeling of love but nowhere to go. And I was like, oh my God. And then it just clicked kind of with the project. And I was like, whoa, there's all this love in me. And even though it has nothing to attach itself to, it's like, I'm here sitting with it and with the pain of this like love, like, whoa. And then my friend had also gone through a breakup very similarly. And we were like talking, we would talk about it. And I was like, oh, I really want to make songs that are like I love love songs, but I don't like how they're kind of like, woe is me. I'm like, I want like powerful love songs, like love songs that are like, I know, but I love, and I have this thing, like just really strong. And my voice is very strong. And I feel like every time, like it was also like something that I had a lot of shame about, is like the intensity of my voice for so long. I was like, I can't sing like really quiet. I can't speak really quiet. When I laugh, it's really loud. It's like kind of been a source of shame for me. And I was like, fuck that. This is just the way I am. Things come out of my body in a really strong way. My friend Teeny was like, it's great. Use it. Let's do it. Really encouraged it. And when I came back in March to New York, and then that month, or maybe less than a month, we came up. I wrote the songs, showed it to them. We jammed out. Sarah Galdez is a drummer, amazing drummer. And they all wrote their own parts for the music. I came in with like the concept, and I wrote like everything. And then would show it to them, would kind of go back to myself, keep writing, keep sending them tracks. Very annoying. I'm very annoying to work with, because I'm like, I really want people to be involved. Mm-hmm. So yeah, but their encouragement and support really unleashed a part of me that I had been hiding from myself. Because I was like, I don't want to be too loud. I don't want to be too like, I'm already, people already think I look like a bitch. But I'm like, no, fuck this. Time to go.
Right. I love that moment in the show when you're like, sorry that I showed my intensity. And then you're like, I personally think it's okay to be deep. Yeah. And, you know, we've talked about like, the scream, like your the scream, which for me is like one of your signature like threads throughout your work. Mm-hmm. and like the ability to be loud and to be able to have all this range of emotion. And yeah. I wonder could you tell us like, how'd you learn to scream like that?
Well, you know this story.
I know, but I'm doing it for entertainment
purposes. I know, it's good. You're so good at this. So I was really into hardcore music when I was a kid in Miami. I'm from Miami, Florida. And I was like so into hardcore. It was like the time of like emo. Like emo started becoming hardcore music. Hardcore music became screamo. That was like when screamo and emo intertwined. I was like so into it. And it was like all these people who are probably canceled now. I mean, they're not canceled, but it's like, it was like kind of indie, kind of like, I was very into Taking Back Sunday, which was like really pop. It's like the pleasures of pop music. And then these like these boys screaming about how they love these girls, these underage girls or whatever. Like gotcha. Super pervy. But I loved it and I still do, which sucks. That's a part of me. I'm like, canceled. But I would practice at all. A lot of my friends were in hardcore bands, and my dream at the time was to be in a hardcore band, like to be the lead singer in a hardcore band. Cause I really felt those songs. I was really into Under Oath. My mom's very Christian and she'd be like, this sounds like devil's music. And I'd be like, no, but Under Oath was actually like a screamo band that was Christian. So I could trick her kind of to like letting me play that and scream along to it in the car. And she was like, oh my God. Cause I would do it full voice around my mom screaming like every day, like insane when I think about it now, like sometimes doing like Billie Holiday and then the other times doing like just like, in this, this, it sucked for it her.
Paid off.
Yeah, but it paid off. It paid off. I had friends in hardcore bands who would teach me how to like scream from my diaphragm.
Oh my God. Just
to like not hurt myself. Yeah. And I was in choir and stuff. So, and I would sing every day as a kid, like try to I'm like very into mimicking or kind of like, oh, seeing a voice and like trying to imagine having it and then like trying to recreate it for myself is like it's just like a thing I did a lot and I still do.
It all that training is so amazing. And I kept thinking about the phrase like hardcore non-binary kept coming to me throughout this piece. And I was like, I'm like such a softcore non-binary. Like I was like, I'm like in the suburbs of Boston listening to like Sarah McLachlan. Do you know what I mean? It was like,
yeah, no, I'm a hardcore non-binary.
You're a hardcore non-binary.
But I'm like, no, I would say I'm a screamo non-binary.
You're so screamo.
I'm emo and screamo. I'm not hardcore.
Okay, right. Thank you for that. There's this moment that I'm like, I have all these things I want to ask you. And also like there's this moment in where you have the musicians turn away from you after you finish a song and you turn, whenever you talk to them, you have them turn their backs to you. And even one time you go to give a high five and they don't, so you give yourself a high five.
Uh-huh.
I just love that. I love the comedy of it. And I just love like the heartbreak of, will you say something about that, about having that, orchestrating that?
Yeah. So I feel like, so whenever I do a show or that show I had done a couple of times in public and then I would like talk to my band members about the idea of it. And I was telling them, and I told the designer, lighting designer too, I was like, oh, the world that we're in, this is, I drew it. It's like I started thinking about like, where's my voice coming from? Or like when I sing, it fills something in me. So it feels good to do. And when I play guitar, it feels good to do. Started noticing it was from here. And I was like, oh, what is that? And I started thinking about like, what is that? And I drew it. And what I drew was like a little tunnel. Like, so there's a little tunnel here where I am and where the, I'm like, oh, this is where the concert is. It's in this hole where I'm totally alone. And the two band members, they come into the hole and they're being affected by like the loneliness of it, but they're still kind of, they're trying to take me out of it. Like they're trying to like get me to the other side of the hole. But they also like kind of are done, like they're annoyed with my sadness is like the whole point of it. And so that was something that was like improvised in the space, where I was like, oh, wait, can you guys like turn away from me? Cause one of my band members was like, oh, what should we do? Like what, asked for direction. And was like, oh, should we be like really robotic or like go along with it? And I was like, oh no, actually you guys should be like reject me.
Yeah.
I think that would be like really funny for this because it would make me feel even lonelier. and also it was a good way of like, cause sometimes I try to make them laugh, like if we've performed together and it's like, oh, how do we hide the laughing? It's like, just turn away from me. So most of the time they're like laughing, turning away. And it was like an easy kind of thing. And also like, cause I was in the space, I was like activated. So we played the whole show through as if it was a real show. And so the energy of the, there were some people watching and I was like, oh, this would be like really funny, a really funny choice to do. And I loved how it turned out.
Yeah, it was so beautiful. And maybe you could talk about Tatiana Tenenbaum, who shot the video, and what was it like to do that collaboration?
Super easy. Yeah, I was like, I want shots like this, like a center shot, a shot of the whole thing, whatever. And then I was like, we're also going to do this dance. And she was down. And she was like, what do you picture in the dance? But it was very simple to work with her. I felt like she really got it.
Mm-hmm.
And also I was also very open to whatever happens. Mm-hmm. Like I'm always really open. I'm not like a, we're gonna do it this way, control. I'm more of like, okay, let's invite people in and see what we create together, because I'm not doing this alone, you know?
Right.
So everyone I'm working with had an interpretation of what I my idea was. But yeah, I was surprised with Tatiana. I'm like, oh, this is somebody I would have totally like picked to work with. That was just like kind of given, mm-hmm. Which was really cool.
Mm-hmm.
Cause she was, I think she said she was like, most of the time she's like just archiving the work. And I'm like, oh, I just made you guys do like a whole music video concert. And I don't know. I feel like every time I go into spaces, that's what I end up doing. I'm like, how can I milk this for all it's worth? Yeah.
You can really feel Tatiana being a performer herself, you know, in the shooting of it. And you mentioned the dance part, and it was so great to get to see you dance. And I feel like it was, you know, in this piece, as we've talked about, it's like a concert format where you're like telling some jokes and stories in between, and then you're singing these songs, and then cut in between is these beautiful shots of you dancing in like kind of a ghost sheet. And it was so great. I had never seen you like dance on stage before. I mean, I've seen you actually not sometimes on stage, but maybe not as long, maybe for not as yeah. long. So what was it like to get to do that?
That was so fun. I had so much fun doing that. I'm very new to being in my body, like to feeling embodied in my body. So, and also pandemic was also like part of that, where I started like dancing in my room or in my rooftop, and it felt really good. And I was like, oh, whoa, like I've never tried this before. Was still a little shy. And then the Baryshnikov thing came in, and I was like, wait, maybe I should dance. Maybe this is a sign to dance. And I also have something coming up with the Gibney next year. And I'm like, okay, funny. And then also for the Gibney thing, I'm working with my friend, Alex Tatarsky, and we said to each other, we were like, what if we trade spaces and you do something that's all spoken and I do something where I don't speak and I just try to express myself with movement? And then this came along and I was like, let me use this opportunity to explore dance. And I've always loved dance. Like I've always loved like experimental dance. Because it's just like Yvonne Rainier and Trisha Brown, mm-hmm. and Pina Bausch, and I really love like people expressing through their bodies, because it's like, oh, you need nothing else, like you have all mm-hmm. the things to kind of like spark imagination, spark like new images to people to inspire. And I think that's really beautiful. I've always wanted to do that, but I've always felt like such shame. Again, with the shame, it's mostly like breaking out of all that shame and being like, fuck it, mm-hmm. I'm gonna do it. Let's see what this body does. And I'm really happy with it. And that's now it's like a new practice in my life that when I like something, I go in really hard. Like I try to perfect the way I do it, because I have so much respect for pre-existing forms of things. But I also like to break form a lot. So yeah, I'm on a new dance journey now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it feels like every time you find a new tool, you just you integrate it so much into your practice, and it becomes like, I remember when you integrated like drawing with the inside of performances and would draw, you know, it's like it becomes so deeply a part of it.
Yeah.
And it was really cool to get to see you use everything. And I wanted to ask, you know, there's a few of the Jesus Platano song, and there's a
oh, you're frozen.
Oh, am I frozen?
Oh, you were.
Am I back?
Okay.
Oh, I'm back. I'm so glad to be back. My internet connection is unstable. Not the only thing that's unstable about me.
But that's great because we have 5 minutes left. So it's
perfect.
Okay.
Perfect. There's this line that you said where you're like, for a second, my entire family was entirely tuned into the fearful reality of a spiritual dimension. And it feels like that's kind of like so much of the piece is like being, you're like turning towards and reveling in the fear of a spiritual dimension. Like, it feels like that's so much of what this whole, like even you're reveling in the rejection, like you're turning towards fear, you're turning toward, you know, and this is so much in your work. And I just wondered if, you know, if you could talk about that, like your own, what moves you towards that and why you want to bring us to face death and to face intensity and rejection together.
So deep. I'm like, I personally have to, in my life, I've never fear is something that's only hindered me. I guess also I think maybe subconsciously having been in, because this is about like love, I feel like in relationships with people I've been in, for me to see someone's fear of loving deeply, or for me to see someone doubt themselves or being anxious or anything, I think, you know, that's really, or even in friendships or something, for me, that is like people being too scared to feel their full power. And yeah, I guess I want everybody in the world to tune into their power, because every single person is so powerful. It's sad to see people not to see that or drown that out in some way, either with alcohol or drugs or you know, whatever like external things, to not go within and really see that they have the potential to change reality around them. I just think that that is something people need to know and to feel. And I do that. And every day it's like, it's still like, you know, I doubt myself every day, of course, but I'm also like when I'm doubting myself the most is when I need to remind myself how powerful I am and how able I am to create my dreams in the world. And I feel like I'm so inspired by art, and art is people revealing kind of like their internal worlds, and because they have done that for me, I hope to do that for somebody else, because that, so we can like keep freeing each other.
Thank you, River, for bringing us into your internal worlds and tunnels and dreams, and for making this beautiful work, which you can view online till November 1st. Love you. Thank you, Maria. Thank you, everybody at Bristikov. That's it. That's our show.
Thank you. Bye.